Richard Adler is a distinguished fellow at the Institute for the Future in Palo Alto, California. For more than two decades, he has worked at the intersection of aging, technology, and health. In 2016, he co-led a project at the Institute for the Future on the future of caregiving, which he will be presenting here. Richard holds a bachelor's degree from Harvard, a master's from the University of California at Berkeley, and an MBA from the McLaren School of Business at the University of San Francisco. Please join me in welcoming Richard Adler.
So I happened to be sitting in the far back at the last session, and I discovered either I need new glasses or the slides need bigger print. So, I think that we're a little challenged here just because of the size of this audience. I hope my slides will be visible, but you do have them in the handouts. So, I think that's going to have to be taken into account. So, I am going to talk about the future of caregiving. This is a project that we did last year. It was done at this a place called the Institute for the Future in Palo Alto. And let me just say a few words about IFTF. It is an independent, not-for-profit research group with more than 48 years, actually now 49, of forecasting experience. We're going to celebrate our 50th anniversary next year in 2018, which I believe will make the Institute the oldest ongoing futures organization in the world. We are based right downtown Palo Alto, right in the middle of Silicon Valley, and our research covers a broad territory from health and healthcare to technology, education, the workplace, even human identity. So we do a lot of work on a lot of futures. My interest in the last few years has been focused on health and aging. And so in 2016, we were approached by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and asked if we would do a project to explore the future of caregiving. As I'm sure many of you know, Robert Wood Johnson, huge foundation in the area of health and healthcare, but in the last few years, they've broadened their focus, I think, in a very promising way, and have somehow decided that caregiving had something to do with health, that it wasn't just clinics and hospitals that were providing health, but there was this other unknown territory, and they asked us to help them to learn about that. Our first step was a very comprehensive literature review and a series of interviews with experts to get a sense of the territory, and we found some interesting facts. First of all, according to the largest, most recent survey, about 43.5 million adults in the United States, 18% of the entire adult population over age 18, reported that they had provided some kind of unpaid care to a family member or friend in the previous 12 months. So one in five Americans is involved with that. And by the way, about 15 million of those, almost a third of those providing care, are involved with somebody with dementia or Alzheimer's, so a very substantial part of that world, 15.7 million care for somebody with Alzheimer's. And about 80% of all care at home is provided by unpaid caregivers, sometimes called informal, although one of the experts we interviewed argued with that calling them informal really demeans their role. Part of our problem is we don't really have good language, and I think this is something Raj will talk about too. While about 20% are provided by paid caregivers. And finally, nearly one quarter, about 23% of caregivers provide 40 or more hours of care a week. So a full-time job for a quarter of caregivers. And in addition, there's been research that shows that up to half of all caregivers are called on at one time or another to perform complex medical tasks, giving injections, wound care, catheters, often with little training or support from the healthcare system. And in addition, approximately 60%, more than half of people who are giving cares are employed, and many experience major conflicts between their jobs and their responsibilities as caregivers. Some of them have to cut back hours, some quit. It's a genuine problem. Well, there was some good news that we found when we did our study, and that is that the whole topic of caregiving, just in the past 4 or 5 years, has received substantially more attention than it has, mainly because of the good work of researchers and advocates. For example, in the last presidential campaign, both presidential candidates explicitly listed programs for caregivers, the first time that's ever happened. And in September, the Institute on Medicine came out with a major report called Families Caring for an Aging America that called on the US to develop a national caregiving strategy. So that's very good news. In fact, the model, and you'll see this slide again in a few minutes from Raj, this came from a project Raj and I did together, and we both liked it so much we both use it, that we sort of see care, the formal healthcare system, is kind of the tip of the iceberg, and underneath this huge, you know, the 90% of the iceberg, which is families giving care on a daily basis, but largely invisible. So that's the good news. The bad news is that almost all of the experts see that there's trouble ahead. It's not hard to find headlines like these that talk about a looming caregiver crisis, a coming caregiver cliff. Well, what's this all about? Well, it's pretty simple. The number of people who will need care, people over the age, particularly of 80 and 85 years old, is growing much faster than the part of the population, the younger people, who are typically available to provide care. So the ratio, which was like 7 potential caregivers to every care recipient, has fallen to 4 to 1 and will fall even further to 3 to 1. Well, clearly, from the basis of our research, it's clear that action is needed to provide better support for caregivers. But the question is, what kind of action? What is it that we might do? Well, in order to answer that question, what we ended up doing at the Institute is we did what we called 3 scenarios for a crisis averted. Rather than doing a best case scenario or a worst case, we thought, well, let's look at the kinds of interventions that might help. And so we told 3 stories. These were set in 2031. This was 15 years in the future. And we did those 3 scenarios. The first one, which we're going to take a look at, was called Angels in the Floorboards. It's about the role of technology, and that's the one we're going to look at. The second one and the third one, we won't have time to look at them, but the second one is about the closer integration of informal family care with the formal healthcare system. We imagine the creation of a new category we called certified caregiver, who is actually trained by medical personnel to provide care. And the third one we called neighbors care, and it was looking particularly at those larger portion of the population who have no family to care for them, like LGBT, and how new social and financial relations might help. So I want to just, we're going to look at the one scenario, which is around informal care, which is about the role of technology. We'll run about 2.5 minutes, and let me see if I can make it go.
I really like my new job as a customer service manager at our local food co-op. The work is demanding but rewarding. Of course, managing my family as well as my job is a challenge. I have 2 active kids who need me to stay on top of their needs and schedules, even when I'm at work. One big help has been Oscar, our family's digital assistant, who keeps tabs on us so we can stay organized and connected. He schedules our medical appointments, pays our bills, even helps plan our meals and family outings. But this year, I've learned what my mom meant when she talked about being in the sandwich generation when she raised me and took care of her parents. Since my dad passed away last year, she's been living on her own, and her Parkinson's disease is making it harder for her to take care of herself. I see her as often as I can, but she's over an hour away, so we've been experimenting with new technologies to help fill the gaps. Fortunately, my dad had installed a bunch of smart systems in their home to automate things like security and energy management. Their system even orders groceries to be automatically delivered to the house. When he passed away, we added a new module that keeps track of my mom's health and her activities. At first, the system was buggy and kept sending out false alarms. But after a bunch of tweaking and a lot of frustration, it seems to be more reliable now. There have been other small technologies that have helped, like the stabilizing utensils that help with her tremors, but the most useful gadget has been Cleo, our telepresence robot. Mom was skeptical about having a robot in her house, but she soon discovered that she could use Cleo to visit with friends who lived in other cities. She also likes the fact that she can use it to visit with her grandkids almost every night. The next upgrade will be to add arms to Cleo to help Mom in and out of the bed and bath. All this technology isn't cheap, but it's less expensive than hiring a full-time caregiver or moving Mom into an assisted living facility. We even found a pharmaceutical company that partially covers the cost in exchange for access to her health data. I really appreciated the value of having all this stuff at 6 o'clock this morning. I got an alert from my mom's medical monitor that she seemed to be having a bad reaction to one of her new meds. I checked on her using Cleo, and she seemed very groggy, so I asked Oscar to send a message right away to her healthcare team. In a few minutes, we were able to set up a three-way call, and her care team coordinator did a quick assessment and changed the dosage for the drug. After work, I'll go over to the house to check on her in person, but I was relieved that I didn't have to barrel down there in my pajamas first thing in the morning. By the time I got to Mom's house, she seemed to be better, but I discovered a new problem. She's kept an active life online, and even though I've warned her about online scams, she was worried about an urgent message that her home monitoring system was vulnerable to attack, which she needed to pay $1,000 to upgrade. With Oscar's help, I was able to report the scammer and update the security settings to prevent it happening again. Now I just need to figure out why the thermostat in Mom's house insists on keeping the temperature at 90 degrees. You know, sometimes it seems like managing the technology is a whole new set of caregiving responsibilities. I do worry about my in-laws in the country who are getting older and don't have access to all of this tech, but hopefully I won't have to deal with their needs for a few more years.
So that's the question. Could technology alleviate the burdens of caregivers and improve the quality of caregiving? There's a lot packed into there. We put maybe a little too much. One of the messages is that technology is almost always a two-edged sword. It's going to solve some problems, but it'll bring its own. So we tried not to be utopian or Pollyanna about it. The scenarios are all online, and I encourage you to take a look at them. We also created a toolkit. It's a printed guide, which you can download and print out, and it's designed to help a group of people use the scenarios to think about the future of caregiving and various strategies. So it's all on the web. This is the URL. It's in the handout. And I encourage you to take a look. As I say, there are three of these scenarios looking at three different stories. So that's my main story. But I just wanted to end by pointing out that we did these for 15 years in the future. And then even as the project was finishing, I kept discovering companies who are delivering today the technologies that we were viewing in the future. And here's just a couple of examples. Safely You is a spin-off from Berkeley's Artificial Intelligence Lab at UC. They're developing a computer vision-based safety technology for home and community Alzheimer's care, particularly designed to avoid falls. And in their first pilot study, they showed an 80% reduction in fall rate in one memory care community, and they're in the process of expanding that pilot. So AI, I think, is one of the technologies that maybe we can talk more about, very powerful. OmniLabs, you know, there was that cute little robot who comes in that lets you talk. Well, that OmniLabs has it. There it is. They just ran an Indiegogo campaign and raised 130% of the money they wanted. It's a bunch of young kids out of Stanford. And I asked them when I met with them, I said, you know, are you going to manufacture these things in China? They said, no, in Fremont, we 3D print them. So you can go online and you can buy one of these little robots. You've got a little screen on top where the face is, and then you can steer it around and be present visually. And then finally, the Amazon Echo. This is a technology. How many people here have Echoes already? Quite a few. So this is this little voice-activated thing, and it's been discovered that particularly for people with early-stage Alzheimer's who tend to ask the same questions over and over again, Alexa is extremely patient. She will answer those questions without getting impatient or say you've asked me 10 times before. And it's actually another example. It's a combination of AI and voice processing that, this is not a technology designed for caregivers or for Alzheimer's, but it's out in the market and is something that we think can be very helpful. So that's a little glimpse of what we think some of the technologies of the future will be. Thank you.